very deep and very clear. I want to be able to devote my time to it. But James is, it's very deep, but it's very simple. Talks about some deep things, but it's very simple and applicable to our lives. And James starts off in the book, and if I had a title for the message today, it'd be The Pressures of Life, The Struggle is Real, whatever you want to call it. We all deal with something. There's three types of people in this room. There's somebody that's coming out of a trial, there's somebody that's going into a trial, and there's somebody that's in a trial right now. Yeah. You know? We all face difficulty. We all face discouragement. We all face trials. We all face tribulation. And that's not just to sit here and say, hey, you know, let's just kick the rock and be done with it, you know? No. Jesus didn't do that. He went through everything, right? We sang about it today. He endured everything. And he continued on. He pressed on. And I like the verse in the Bible when it talks about praying. The Bible says he went a little further and prayed. And he came back and then he went a little further and prayed. He pressed on. He kept going. That's what we need to do as Christians. But James talks about here in chapter 1. We're only going to read the first three verses. And he's very specific about certain things. James 1:1, the Bible says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations, knowing this, through the trying of your faith, work of patience. You see a bunch of words there. Servant, you see trial, you see temptation, you see diverse temptations, meaning many, more than one. I like to have many, much money, but I don't like to have many, much troubles, right? Money doesn't fix those problems either. And then we have trials, and we have faith, and then we have that one word that we're all great at, and that's the word patience. I'm horrible at it. I'm horrible at it. And I was at a diversity training for the sheriff's office a couple weeks ago, and we had a guy there, and I kind of wrote him off because he was a very, very portly man. And man, what are they going to send this guy here? He's going to teach us about defensive tactics. He can't do anything to defend himself. And he's a very smart man. He had 3 PhDs. He teaches at Johns Hopkins. And I wrote him off at the beginning, and then he started talking about me. This guy knows a lot. I need to show him. Listen. And he said, I can tell by your actions and your attitude where your grandmother's from. I said, okay. Enlighten me, tell me, show me how that you can tell where my grandmother came from. And he said, not just me in particular, but everybody in the room. And he said, how many of you, you're a precise person. You like to be on time. You don't like to be late for anything. You like to do this and do that and have everything lined up and all your ducks in a row. And you don't just go with the flow. Of course, most of us raised their hand, and he said, well, I know that your grandmother, most likely your grandmother, was raised in the Northern Hemisphere of America. Okay, so he said, went on to explain about how, people down south, they're come as you are, go as you want to, come as you please, go as you want to go. They're very laid back, and southern, that's the only word I know how to explain, southern, they take the time, they don't, not in a hurry, so you don't get told you're number one while you're driving down the road all the time. And, it's the total opposite. You go up in the New Jersey Turnpike, it's the quick and the dead. That's it. But he said, if that's the case, if your grandma's probably from the Southern Hemisphere. I said, how do you know all this? He said, well, think about it. He said, in the Northern Hemisphere, they have shorter growing periods. So people are more precise with their time. They don't waste the time. They got growing periods of growing seasons, and they got to get their things in and get them done before the winter comes. Unlike us, who we're still dealing with winter and the springtime. Really confused. But he said that down south, their growing seasons are extremely long. I mean, they can grow more. So they have that laid-back attitude. Whereas up in the Northern Hemisphere, people, they didn't have enough food to put on the table because of the winter. And the farmer would have to sell his cow, which in a sense was his tractor, to feed his family. And then come springtime, he doesn't have a tractor, so what's he going to do? So it was very precise, and he went on to explain that. But we talked about patience, and patience is a virtue of a mature Christian. And our patience should be increasing as we spiritually mature. Why? Because the presence of patience and the exercising of patience, it shows us we must be submissive to the will of God for our lives. Why? Because he knows all. He's sovereign. He's in control of certain situations. We don't understand it. And even though we may question him, there's nothing wrong with questioning God and asking him why. He doesn't have to answer this. But I think of all this, me included, we all need to exercise our patience. What he talks about these very hard but simple things: temptations, trial, and patience. And I learned the hard way. I'm very quick. I try to get things done quickly, save time, save money. Rather than save time and save money, I ended up spending more money because I didn't follow instructions. And I gave you the example. I was working on installing a door one day, and it was a metal door, one of those metal pole barn doors, the ones that cost like $800, $900. So I was putting a doorknob on it. I was in a hurry. I was trying to get somewhere, and I was like, this doorknob's not fitted. It's not long enough or wide enough. Well, dummy me, I didn't realize that if you read the instructions, it tells you that you can actually flip a knob on the inside latch and extend that doorknob. So here I am with the sawzall making a hole there in the doorknob. And then when I put the doorknob on, there was this huge gap, and I realized I would have just read the instructions and been patient. And now I've been in a hurry, I would have had the phone fill that gap and have a draft of air come through. But patience is a virtue, and it's very true that it is. But James writes here, he says in verse 1, he says, James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. And James is a New Testament book in a nutshell. It's really easy, simplistic gospel things, and things for the life of a Christian, of how we should live our lives, how the Christian home should look, how the church should look, how a Christian should behave, how we should do this and do that. It's very simple. And James breaks it down in verse 3, and he gives us three things I want to talk about, three simple things. Nothing alliterated. I'm not giving you this point and this point and this point. I'm just giving you three truths from each verse. And the first verse is number 1, the inner man always influences the outer man. Listen to what he says. He says, James, a servant of God. Now, who is James? James was the what? He was the brother of Jesus Christ. I mean, Mary and Joseph did not have Jesus. The Holy Spirit, Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and Jesus was born in birth. But Mary and Joseph had no children, and James was one of the brothers of Jesus. James doesn't start off his book by saying, hey, I'm Jesus' brother. You should listen to me. No, he doesn't say that. He doesn't start off and say, hey, I've walked with Jesus for 33 and a half years, where the other guys have walked with him for 3. I was his brother, or I had to watch him do everything. He didn't start off by saying that, or saying, I was a disciple, I witnessed the miracles, or I watched him die on the cross, or I saw his risen body. No, he doesn't say that. He says, hey, James, a servant of Jesus Christ. He talks about and references the inner man. See, it's not who you are, it's whose you are. James realized, hey, it's not about me, it's about Jesus. It's about God. He says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. And James knew that Luke 6:45, as the Bible says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. When Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, he says, you can't get evil out of good, you can't get good out of evil. A good heart's going to bring forth good speech, and a evil heart's going to bring forth evil speech. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And I tell my wife, I'm getting arguments, like everybody else does. Don't tell me you know. You're lying. In the church. See the light falling on your head. You know, we'll say things to each other, but then we'll go back, you know, and kiss and make up and say, I didn't really mean that. And she'll say, I didn't really mean that. And I'll look at her and say, no, you did. She'll look at me and say, no, you did. Why? Because we really are speaking our heart when we get agitated, when we get irritated. We're speaking things that we've thought about. It's on the inside. It's going to come out. And the inner man influences the outer man. It doesn't work the other way around. The inner man influences the outer man. That's why when Paul wrote to the church of Ephesus, he tells him to strengthen the inner man. He didn't say go to the gym and pump iron and work out your body. No, he said body exercise, profit a little, right? Then he also said, I buffet my body. I go to the buffet. No, I'm just kidding. No, he said, bodily exercise profitability. He talked about the inner man. Strengthen the inner man. Why? Because the inside always affects the outside. Yeah. You know, you get that good, juicy apple, but on the inside it's rotten. You can take one bite and throw it away. It can be pretty as you want on the outside, but it's no good on the inside. James begins the book by qualifying saying, he says, hey, I'm a servant of God. He's not a master, he's a minister. He's a minister. We get to the point where we think we're something great. See, Jesus, when the disciples were all gathered around and said, hey, I'm going to be the one at the right hand of God in heaven, and I'm going to sit at the right hand of God. Jesus said, it's not the ones that are preaching, it's not the ones that are speaking that are the greatest. He said, it's the ones that are serving. The serving ones, the ones that serve. That's why with Mary and Martha, the one was sitting at the feet of Jesus, and the other, he told, hey, look, she's chosen that more important thing, to learn to sit at my feet and listen. She's learning to worship. And serving God is worshiping God. Look what he says here. He says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes of the church scattered abroad, greeting. How does one serve? How does one minister to people? Look what he says. He says, I'm a servant of God and of Jesus Christ to somebody else. We think that when we leave here, we're done. No, we're not. We take the gospel from here to other people who need it. We take the ministry of the Church of Jesus Christ to people who need it. When we stop serving others, that's when we stop serving God. If we don't serve others, we're not serving God. We come here and we sing songs about how we worship and we love the Lord, but we're going to go out here and we're not going to take the gospel but to certain people or people that we think won't be offended, that won't be offended, but the other ones will just leave them be. We fail. The way to effectively serve God is to serve the people God has called us to serve. That's how we serve the Lord. You want to serve God? You want to serve Jesus Christ? Start serving God in your home first. Husband, serve your wives, serve your children's wives, serve your husband, serve your children's children, serve your parents by being obedient and honoring them. And then once you get that, then you can serve out here. A lot of people want to put the cart before the horse. The home was instituted first. If things go wrong in the home, they're going to go wrong everywhere else. And that's a good example of what's happening today. We have a battle. We have a battle for our minds. We have a battle for the body. But he talks here in verse number 1. He says, the servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. And he talks about all sorts of things. The context of this passage is he's referring to the 12 tribes that were scattered. Why were they scattered? They were scattered because the portion of the scripture here that we're talking about, James, was written following the stoning of Stephen. Now who stoned Stephen? Who was in charge of that?
Paul.
And now Saul would persecute Christians and he would go throughout the cities and he would literally throw Christians in jail for worshiping God. Throw Jews in jail for worshiping God. And by the grace of God, God changed him and saved him. But this is who James is writing to. He's writing to those that are scattered. And he says, hey, we need to serve. Number two, not only does the inner man affect the outer man. Number two, the pressures of life will come and we must learn how to handle them. Look what he says. He says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. And in verse 3, he talks about the trying of your faith. The word trying means trials. So you have temptations, you have trials. They're two different things. And James says, it's not if it's going to happen, it's when is it going to happen. When are we going to fall into temptation? When are we going to fall into trials? When are we going to have that bad bill of health be announced at the doctor's office? When am I going to lose a loved one? And he says, the trying of your faith, the work of patience in your life. I was always told never pray for patience because you'll learn the hard way. But God wants us to do certain things and God wants us to trust Him and He wants us to lean on Him. The pressures of life will come and we must learn how to handle them. He says, the trying of faith worketh patience. It produces something. Somebody once said, a faith not tested is a faith not to be trusted. If your faith is not able to be put to the test, why would you want to trust? Listen, my God has been tried and proven. And he's proven to win every time. And guess what? He defeated that one thing called death that we couldn't defeat. He defeated death by death. Think about that. He used death to defeat itself. How cool is that? But he says, hey, try your faith. Faith not tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. And James writes to the person in the Christian church and he tells him, listen what he says. Verse 2, he says, count it all joy. What is joy? Joy is like the bottom of the ocean. No matter what's going on top, it's still calm, it's still serene. The waves may billow on top, but deep down, there's still that deep-seated joy. Why do I have joy? Because the joy of the Lord is my strength. The Bible says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The Lord is my high tower. He is my strength. He is my salvation. Whom shall I fear? I put my trust in the Lord rather than put my confidence in man. There's no greater than He. He is my hope. So that's how James can write to these Christians who are being persecuted, murdered, butchered for their faith and say, hey, count it all joy.
Because we're going to talk about it in a little bit, about how when persecution comes, other people are going to look at that and they see how sincere people really are, what they really believe in, and they want to turn and accept Christ as their Savior as well. When you think about the trials of life, the pressures of life are going to come, but we as Christians, we need to learn how to handle them. Of all people, of all people that walk this earth, those that have the hope of Jesus Christ, the Bible says that lies within them, should have the ability to handle the pressures of life. And I'm not saying we're perfect, and sometimes we're not going to give in to temptation, but we will. But listen, we have that steadfast hope. We have the Word of God. We have direct access to the Father by prayer. We don't need to go to a priest and pray to him and have him pray to God. We get to go into the presence of God because of what Jesus Christ did, because we're justified, because we're sanctified, because we're set apart.
Amen.
Because of his shed blood on the cross and his death and his burial and resurrection. We have that direct access.
Amen.
But we don't use it. Multiple trials just mean multiple ways to be refined.
Amen.
Multiple trials just mean multiple ways to be refined. Think about the most precious elements in the world. Think about the pearl. How is the pearl made? A grain of sand that irritates the water. The oyster, right? And by that process of irritation, by the process of you know, a lack of comfort, that pearl is made. Think about gold. How is gold made? Through what? A refiner's fire, right? Intense heat. And it's brought to an intense heat that draws and scooped off the top of it, the impurities of that, and it's solid out through gold, one of the most precious elements of the world. Think about diamonds. How are diamonds made? They're made through what? Constant pressure. Constant pressure. Think about film. How were photos made back in the dark ages when nobody had any fun? And we had cell phones. You don't have cell phones. You remain in a dark room, and God wants to develop us in the darkness, and he does develop us in the darkness more than he develops us in the light. Because it reveals our need for him. It's during the test. It's during the test that the teacher becomes silent. Took a test and I looked around and watch where the teacher's at. He's watching me. Doesn't make a sound. But he's taught me all these things. He ran his mouth for 3 weeks and they told me we're going to have a test on him and tell you to take notes. And he didn't take notes. And you're out of luck. But during the test, you can't ask any questions to get answers to the test, can you? Is the teacher still there? Yeah, he's still there. Was God still there when Job was asking questions when it seemed like God was gone? No, God was still there. Job was just trying, and God was just trying his faith. God was testing his faith. And Job passed the test. There's two types of trial things we're going to talk about. Outward pressures. Number one is the outward trials, and number two is the inward temptations. The outward trials. I don't want to necessarily focus on the outward trials. I more or less want to focus on the inward temptations, because we all face outward trials. We all face inward temptations, but it's inward temptations that cause us to stumble most of the time. See, the battle is not won in the gym. Okay? I mean, you guys watch March Madness, you know, the Loyola of Chicago wasn't the biggest, baddest team on the block. No, but they had the mindset to win and go as far as they wanted to. UMBC was the biggest, baddest team on the block. Virginia was. They were the number one seed, but guess what? They didn't have that mindset to win the game. Doesn't matter how much you pump iron, physically strong you are, but the battle's won or lost in the mind. Every day I get up and go to work, I put that vest on and I realize, hey, I might not come home today. But if I find myself in a gunfight for my life, I'm doing everything I can to win, come back home and see my kids. It's a mindset. It's called the warrior's mindset. We're taught and trained to have the warrior's mindset. And why should we have that mindset as Christians? I want the warrior mindset for my kids. I'm going to fight tooth and nail for my kids. I'm going to fight tooth and nail that my kids grow up and learn to love the Lord, because the devil's trying to beat down the door of my home to get in to influence them. He's doing the same thing to your kids. Mm-hmm. I got to have that warrior mindset that their life depends on, because it does. It can and it may. The battle begins in the mind. The battle begins and is won in the mind. And all these battles, all these trials, the outward trials, the inward temptations, they're nothing more than proof that we need the grace of God in our life. They're nothing more than the proof that we struggle with sin and that God
is our Redeemer that we need. That's all they are. And a lot of times we look at those things and we think, man, God, why do you do this to me? Why do you bring this on me? No, God doesn't want us to blame him for things. He wants us to trust him and lean on him more. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, I'm going to turn there real quick. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Paul writes to the church of Corinth, and he says in verse 5, he says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exceeded itself against the knowledge of God. So he's talking about the things that put God down. Alright, the knowledge of God. Put down the knowledge of God. He's like, we need to get rid of those things. We need to cast those things down. And bring into captivity, the last part of the verse here, he says, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So our thought, like he's talking about the importance of the knowledge of God. And how important that our thought life is to whether we win or lose the spiritual battle, the spiritual wars we face. And he says you need to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And that word captivity there, it literally means in biblical times how they would besiege the city. An army would camp around the city and they would literally choke that city to death because they would let nothing in, they would let nothing out. People couldn't buy food, they couldn't do anything. There sometimes they would literally be eating horses. They would starve themselves to death. They would take that city captive. And that's what Paul's writing in the church report. He says, your thought life can control you. If you don't captivate your thought life will captivate you. You end up doing the things you think about. You need to choke it. Your flesh. Don't give into the flesh. Take it into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That's the power of the mind. I'm not talking about mysticism. I'm not talking about anything crazy or whacked out. I'll give you an example here. Let's relax for a minute. Think about the brightest, juiciest, freshest London you can think of right now. You're nuts, Scott. I know. We're going somewhere. Let's trust me. What do you think about that? Literally picture, what color is that London? It's got to be yellow. Okay? Now, I want you to take it in your mind, I want you to take that lemon, I want you to stick it on the counter, I want you to grab the sharpest peri knife you have, I want you to slice into that lemon and let the juices run out all over the counter. Alright, now I want you to pick up the one half of that lemon, I want you to take it in your hand, I want you to squeeze it in your hand, watch the juices run down your elbow with the seeds. I want you to take it and stick it in your mouth. If you're not salivating more now than you were before I talked about the lemon, something's wrong with it. But that's the power of your mind. We can do the same thing with a nice big juicy steak. We're getting hungry now, aren't we? It's lunchtime. Right? I'll get us out of here. You're buying lunch, right? But hey, that's the power of your thought life. The battle is won in the mind. And James says that, hey, take it. And Paul says it too. We need to take into captivity our thoughts. And James talks about those trials, the inward temptations. And he says, hey, count it all joy. I thought about some of these temptations and some of these trials. What are the purposes? What is God trying to teach you and teach me through these trials, through these tribulations, and through these circumstances? Number one, he wants to, and a lot of times we don't allow him to, but these tribulations and these trials, they're meant to strengthen our faith. They're meant to make our faith stronger. They're not meant to make us weaker. They're meant to make us better. They're meant to make us more like Christ. It's to strengthen our faith. And a lot of times we get through something, we go through something, we start to blame God, we get mad, we get angry. I mean, we got people, they go through something, and finally they come to church, they get in the Word of God, and as soon as everything's right, everything's cured, guess what happens? They forsake it. They back out the door, they're living the lifestyle they lived before, and they use God as a credit card to get out of debt, and a credit card to get out of trouble and all that stuff, and they forsake him, and they don't realize, hey, I'm really hurting myself at the cause of Christ. It should strengthen our faith. Number two, it should make us humble by revealing our need for God. Anytime we go through something bigger than us, it should just show how small we are and how great God is. Yeah. Number three, it helps us rely on the spiritual rather than the secular. You know, we'll turn to our friends who don't go to church, or before we turn to a friend who knows the Lord and pray for us. Or we turn to Dr. Phil rather than turn to Dr. Jesus in the book and read what he has to say about it.
Number four, it helps us encourage others.
And don't get mad at me. I'll watch my phone.
Helps us encourage others.
How?
If I went through something and the Lord was good to me through that, and I'm not saying the Lord's going to be good to that person through it, but if he could get me through that, he could possibly get them through that. If he can encourage me, encourage them.
Rather than look at it as something, oh me, oh my, how can I serve, as we talked about in verse 1, someone else through what I'm going through?
Number 5, it reveals our true love. It reveals our sincere love, what we really love. Do we really love God, or do we love ourselves? Are we in love with the comfort that we have? Are we in love with the ease of life that we have? Are we really in love with God? Because when things get tough, do we trust Him, or do we trust ourselves, or do we blame God?
Number 6, it helps us develop a heavenly hope. How so? Because we continue to develop a trust more and more each day. I trust God more today than I did yesterday. I trust Him more now than I did yesterday.
So what were these brethren dealing with that James talks about? He talks about the inner man. He talks about himself. He's a servant. He's humble. He says, I'm not anybody. I'm a servant of God. I'm serving others. He talks about the difficulties they're going to face. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation, knowing this is the trial of your faith, working patience. But then he talks about the patience, and you can read on. And James, we're not going to read it today. He's talking about the persecution they're facing. The very thing that they were dealing with was the reason they were scattered in verse 1. The very thing that they were dealing with was the reason that they were scattered. They were persecuted. And he tells them, he says, in verse 2, he says, my brethren, count it all joy because you're producing something. God's producing something in your life if you allow it to happen. If you allow the process to be completed, God's going to produce something greater than what you have in you right now. Number 3, religious persecution produces the proclamation of the gospel. It's funny how that always works. Listen, the faith of a believer should never make sense to the world. They shouldn't be able to explain it. Because, you know, the tomb, the empty tomb, that's a proclamation that my Redeemer lives to me. To the lost person, they have to try to explain that away. They have to make sense of that somehow. You know, I can make sense of it by showing you the Bible, what God says. If you don't trust God and His Word and believe that He is who He says He is, then there's no point, really. But it's funny how that always works. Religious persecution always brings more Christians. Why? Because persecution allows the real sincere ones to rise to the occasion. It'd be really easy to stand in here and say, hey, I died for Christ. A lot of us would raise our hand just out of peer pressure because everybody else would. See, we, as a church, we try to, yeah, let's die for Christ. Have you tried to live it for Him? You're going to say you're going to die for Him. You should be able to live for Him. And that's part of the problem we have today. You see, we go to the other countries around the world. Iraq has 150,000 Christians that are imprisoned in concentration camps for their faith in the gospel. There's countries in Thailand, or churches in Thailand and China, where they're given an hour to worship. 1 hour a week, and as soon as the 55-minute mark rolls up on the clock on that hour service, they have armored tanks, armored jeeps, and army men roll up to drag people out of church if they don't end the service right at an hour and put them in prison for their faith. There's people in China, probably one of the largest growing populations of Christians in China, that literally still meeting underground because of their faith, because they could be killed for their faith in Jesus Christ. And we get upset when somebody doesn't like us or doesn't like what we say, or they get mad at us on Facebook and take us off of their friend page and all that stuff because we posted on a couple verses. Come on. If we really went over there and if they came over here and saw what we had and saw how insincere we are, we would be laughing. And James looks at him and says, hey, you're being eaten by lions, you're being drunk through the sea by horses, beheaded, buried in your neck up to the sand, wait for high tide to come by and drown you. Hey, count it all joy. Why? Because He did it for me.
Amen.
He did it for me. And the instability in our lives will either destroy us or they will develop us. And
only way they would develop is if we counted all joy, as he says in verse 2. I'm not happy about the circumstances, but listen, I'm glad that I get to go through what I go through, because he went through much more than I did. Because I want to live for him. Now, I'll close with this. You know, the blood of persecution is the foundation of the church. You guys read Fox's Book of Martyrs. You young people, I would suggest you read it. I read it a handful of times to see people who gave their life for their faith in Christ. The blood of persecution is the foundation of the church. You think about all the apostles, all the disciples. They were all martyred. Peter was crucified upside down because he wasn't worthy to be crucified as his Savior. They were going to crucify him on a cross. He said, no, turn me upside down because I don't want to die the same way my precious Lord and Savior died. John was the only one who survived, and he survived to live on a deserted island for the rest of his life, as far as we know. He's thrown in hot oil, boiled, and he still survives, so they stuck him on an island. That's when God revealed him the revelation of the scriptures. God knew something tragic in his life to teach him something, to reveal something to him. God allows us to experience instabilities because, not because he wants to destroy us, because he wants to develop us as Christians. And I'll give you an illustration here. I'll close with this. I was working a couple months ago, a night shift, I think it was a Sunday night, and I was listening to 95.1, and I got down to Shipyard Landing and was doing a special patrol check down there. They were doing like a singer-songwriter kind of thing on early morning service. Program, and they introduced this new song, and the songwriter, her name's Audrey Assad. She's actually a Syrian refugee, and her father came from Syria and brought her here and raised her. She's a Christian, and she wrote this song. It's called Even Unto Death, and if you want to Google it, you can Google it. It's on YouTube. It's called Even Unto Death by Audrey Assad, and she was talking about the events that happened in 2015, I'm sure you remember, I remember like it was yesterday, those men in those orange jumpsuits that were marched out to the Mediterranean Sea by those men in those black hoods and were executed for their faith in Jesus Christ. And not just them, there's many other videos that they've thrown out there, I guess to scare us. But she said, in a world filled with death, in a world where death is both the weapon and the wound, my faith is shaken. This is in the words of the song. I'm going to read them here in a minute. This is her in the words about the song. You must remember that day months ago when I saw the video of those 21 precious Egyptian men kneeling on a Mediterranean beach. You remember them, don't you? They in their orange jumpsuits, prisoners of the black-clad soldiers standing behind them. I stared at the procession and knew that I was looking into the sickening, quaking black hole that was dead. A message signed with blood to the nation of the cross was the text on the screen. I shivered as I had never shivered, my blood ran cold in my veins. Blessings and peace be upon the one sent by the sword, their veiled leader said, his knife poisoned in the air. The captives prayed, their lips moving silently, their eyes closed, for some eyes were raised to heaven. What were they whispering in those last fast-fading moments of their lives? Were they afraid? What did they say to the God who was beside, before, and behind them? The soldiers stood stock, still, in the wind, knives at the ready. Then they cut through the flesh, vein, and bone, their merciless blades attempting to assuage the hunger of death, but death could not be satiated, for even death is dying. All is not as it seems. The men wielding the knives, they were precious also, though they did not know it. They are also prisoners of death. The 21 men that they beheaded, they are miraculously, blessedly free now. This is the great paradox of Christianity, that Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. I have to believe that these 21 martyrs were each in the kingdom of heaven interceding for their executioners. Think about that. Interceding for those that just took their life. They're pleading for Christ's blood to cover their sins. I could not help but weep. And weep hard. Leave all souls to heaven, especially those in most need of thy mercy, I thought desperately. But by some small miracle, I did not despair. I only thought, what would I pray if it were me kneeling on that beach? And these are the words of it. She said, Jesus, the very thought of you fills my heart with love. Jesus, you burn like wildfire, and I am overcome. Lover of my soul, even unto death, with my every breath I will love you. Jesus, you are my only hope, and you my prize shall be. Jesus, you are my glory now and in eternity. Lover of my soul, even unto death, with my every breath I will love you. I will wait for you. I am not forsaken. Though I lose my life, though my breath be taken, I will wait for you. I am not forsaken. One thing I desire is to see you in your beauty. You are my delight. You are my glory. You, my sacrifice, your love is all-consuming. You are my delight. You are my glory. Lover of my soul, even unto death, with my every breath I will love you. As a prayer that she thought they would pray before they were executed. And yet, God wants us to live for him. You think about all the struggles we face here. And think about somebody giving their life for the cause of Christ. Those men probably could have denied their faith and be let go. Story after story of people who were executed at the stake, guillotined, they were told to deny their faith, but they did not. And they stood the test of time. Their blood is the foundation of the church. Because they realized serving him is more important than serving themselves. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your truth. May you help us to realize it's not about us, it's about you, Lord. It's not about anything else but you. May you help us to live for you and realize that we can strengthen the inner man each and every day. And may you help us to live in light of the fact that one day you are coming again and that we could face persecution, Lord. May you help us to live for you, not just say we're going to die for you, but live for you each and every day. For it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.